I guess it's Leanne, and I'm here today with the much anticipated, probably not, review for The Last Argument of Kings by Joe Abercrombie. I will now say the thing that I have said in every video since the beginning of 2021. As you know, this year I am rereading all of the First Law books in anticipation of the release of the third and final book in the Age of Madness trilogy by Joe Abercrombie, which comes out in September and is called The Wisdom of Crowds. When I read these books the first time and the second time, I did not do standalone reviews for them, so I'm doing them now. All caught up. This will be non-spoilery as much as possible. Yeah, like I'm gonna avoid spoilers. Like I may inadvertently spoil something earlier in the trilogy. I really don't think that I will have a need to. Cautioning you just in case that does happen. If you don't already know, and if that's not clear from how I introed it, this is the third and final book in the First Law trilogy, which is the first three books in the First Law world, after which comes some standalones. So this wraps up the trilogy arc, but it is not the last book in the First Law universe. This is the only book in the trilogy that I gave 5 stars to the first time that I read it. I have subsequently given all the books in the series, or all the books in the trilogy, 5 stars. This I gave 5 stars to the first go around and ever since continued to give it 5 stars. Because this book is the one where everything makes sense. Everything comes together. Everyone who was like confused or like, is this going somewhere? Is there a point to anything that I've been reading? This is the book that makes you go, oh shit. You mean to say that he and that and this? Like when I talked to my brother about it, I mean, when he finished this book the first time, he was like, well, now I just want to immediately go back and reread the trilogy because like, it turns out stuff was actually being foreshadowed and you had no way to be able to tell that. I've certainly read books where like, it seems like the author is foreshadowing things and you're like, oh, that'll come into it later. Or like, there's something suspicious going on over there. Or I bet this is gonna turn into this. Abercrombie's writing is so just like, you know, grim, dark characters doing grim, dark things, just going about their lives, which is why a lot of people picking it up are like, this is meandering, where's any of this going? Which is fair, but for that reason, then no part of you is thinking that any of these things are actually clues, because they're not really like framed by the author as being clues for things. You're just like, people are doing stuff, that was crazy, that was weird, what is he up to, what a guy. And then when you finish Last Argument of Kings, you're like, my god, I need to go back and reread everything, because that was, yeah, now that I'm thinking, that was foreshadowed. This didn't come out of nowhere. This wasn't like a last minute pantser author being like, well, I gotta have a twist at the end, so I guess this makes sense. Like, no. As soon as the twist happens, it is out of nowhere, and yet it is also definitely not out of nowhere, because then you stop and think and you're like, that checks out. No, that, yep, that, oh, that definitely checks out. Oh, wow. Wow, 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 wow. So, like, this is a weird analogy, but go with me on this. Last Argument of Kings feels like, by the way, I just discovered how horrible it is putting IKEA furniture together. I've never before had IKEA furniture. But like, building any furniture, really. I've been building a lot of furniture. You know that this is supposed to be a thing at the end. But while you're going through steps A through Z, you're like putting these pieces together that you think like, is this gonna be the door to the cabinet? No. Is it the bottom of it? I don't know. But it says, you know, D3 to A7 needs to go like this, so I'm screwing it in and nailing it and attach this piece in the middle. Why am I attaching this piece in the middle? Okay, it says to do that, so I'm gonna do that. And then you pick up like the last few pages of the instruction manual and suddenly these pieces are coming together and fitting and forming a thing and you're like, aha! That wasn't like a pointless configuration of random pieces of wood. This comes together to form a thing and I see it now. Oh wow, like looking back at those instructions on the first pages, how did I not see that those are actually the shelves? Oh wow, okay, this makes sense. And what a sturdy, freaking beautiful chest it is. So what, last time I said before they are hanged was like a road trip and I had an extended road trip metaphor? Well, the metaphor for Last Argument of Kings is IKEA furniture. If you wanna read the grimdark fantasy equivalent of putting together IKEA furniture, then you should read the First Law trilogy. Put that on the cover, that's the blurb for the cover. So obviously I love the series, obviously, obviously. But like the satisfaction that you get from reading the third book where stuff comes together, because that's a lot of what this is. And at the same time, that's not to say there aren't like new things coming into it and new revelations and new developments. It's not just like finally saying, okay, so this thing you've been wondering about, that's what this means, that's what this means. Like there's new revelations, new connections, new threads, a lot of stuff happening. A lot of stuff goes down in this book. It's a thick, I think it's the longest one. I'm pretty sure it's the longest one. It has a lot to wrap up. I don't know, they're all pretty action-packed. I think it's safe to say this is the most action-packed. There's the most, you know, on-screen, like, you know, action scenes, people fighting or violence occurring or stuff like that happening. There are some truly earned and spectacular character interactions that, like, you've kind of been waiting for all three books. Characters that, like, either knew of each other or didn't know of each other, but you knew who they were and were like, at some point, those courses have to collide. So seeing them collide in the most epic ways possible, there's a lot of payoff for character arcs that are not necessarily connections to the plot or anything. Just kind of, like, moments in this book that make you go, oh my god, to think where this character started, to think how I was introduced to them, and to see them where they are now, what they're doing, what they're thinking, how far they've come. And that's not to say that the farness of the coming was a positive turn of events, but, you know, just that, like, wow, like, realizing that you've actually really watched them grow and change over the course of three books. And I think we've all read books where, like, a character has, in some way, the author wants us to believe this character has progressed or changed, but we haven't really seen it happen. We haven't really seen anything to convince us that this character would have gone through such a change. We just kind of have to take the author's word for it. Whereas in the first law books, we spend so much time just with characters, just, like, seeing them reacting to their world and to the people around them and seeing how that begins to shift over time, how they new, like, realizations and awareness of the world begins to color how they interact with the world. So that by the time you read The Last Argument of Kings, if you think of the character as they are now meeting their prior self in The Blade itself, just how different those characters are and, like, what their present self would think of their past self. That you got to see change. You got to see this journey. It wasn't like, you know, fast forward, now they're a different person. You've seen this earned development in them. And that's not to say that they're no longer at all the same person they are. And that's the magic of the character work that Abercrombie does, where, like, at their core, this is recognizably still the same character, but they're very different. Like, they have changed a lot. So it's just like, if for a character-driven reader, The Last Argument of Kings, like, beyond all of the payoff in terms of, oh, it actually did have a plot, oh, actually this all does add up to something. Beyond that, like, just the character payoffs where you've seen this development in a character and it's been explored so thoroughly and so satisfyingly and in a way that you really get to feel like you saw it happen. And, like, there's some excellent moments that just kind of, like, crystallize it, if that makes sense. Like, you've been seeing this happen and you've probably thought to yourself, wow, this character is changing. But just these, like, moments in Last Argument of Kings where something the character says or does, and, like, it really just kind of, like, brings to the forefront how different they are now, how much they have changed. I'm completely switching gears. This is something that I haven't brought up in any of the reviews, which, I mean, I wasn't purposely not, and I don't know that I forgot about it. I don't know that I planned to say anything. But one thing that I really like about the titles of the trilogy is that they're all based on quotes that are somehow relevant to the book. Like, the first book, The Blade Itself, is from the longer quote, The Blade Itself Incites to Deeds of Violence. I should probably look these up if I'm going to bring it up at all. Okay, so The Blade Itself is a quote from Homer's The Odyssey, which is, The Blade Itself Incites to Deeds of Violence. So I was correct about that. And then the second book, Before They Are Hanged, the title of that book references a quote by Heinrich Heine, which is, we should forgive our enemies, but not before they are hanged. And then The Last Argument of Kings refers to words that Louis XIV had inscribed on his canons, which is in Latin, ultima ratio regum. I don't speak Latin, probably butchered that. It translates to The Last Argument of Kings, meaning, like, war is the last argument of kings. Anywhoosies, I just like that little additional element, little flavor. And he does like to, he sprinkles in quotes at, like, the beginnings of, like, parts of the book. I know that in A Little Hatred, there's a Terry Pratchett quote at one point. It's just, like, fun little, I just like stuff like that. It's just, like, I don't know what it's like. I just like it. So I'm telling you about it. You're welcome. Now, what is also interesting for me, having read all of the books already, coming back to this now, so this is, I guess, me telling you whether or not these books are also deserving of a reread or what it's like to be rereading them. Having seen where he takes the world, where he takes the series, where he takes these characters in later in the standalones and in now the new trilogy, it's interesting to see seeds that were planted for that already. So similarly to how this book offers, like, an insight or it makes you realize that actually The Blade Itself and Before They Are Hanged wasn't random stuff. Like, it was actually planting a bunch of seeds that paid off in The Last Argument of Kings and you didn't know it was happening. Similarly, having now read the first two books in the Age of Madness trilogy and seeing how the world has shifted and changed, seeing how the groundwork for that shift was already being laid at the end of The Last Argument of Kings, seeing how it isn't like, well, what if in the 30 years interim, what if the world just changed a bit? And you just, I mean, if an author did that, like, I mean, you would be like, well, yeah, I guess stuff would happen in that 30 year interim, so that would change the world, I guess. But you see in The Last Argument of Kings very easily how what has happened and where we leave off at the end of The Last Argument of Kings, how that could lead to the world that we see in the Age of Madness trilogy. It seems like the next logical progression of this world after what goes down in The Last Argument of Kings. So it's kind of hard to talk about this without spoilers, because, like, it's all basically, I mean, I have to be vague. So, like, characters doing things, plots being revealed. So, like, I can't really give specifics, because any specifics would be spoilery for the first two books as well as this book. Basically, this book is fantastic. And I think that if you have gone on this journey so far, like, if Blade itself put you off and you never went further, fair enough. But if you did keep going on this journey, but you kept thinking to yourself, like, I mean, I like this. Like, I do like this. I like his writing. Sure do love Glockta. But, like, is there a point to any of this? This is the book that makes you, that rewards you for having gone along on this journey. And I would still love the trilogy, even if the third book didn't pay off so well, because I still think the character work is brilliant, and I think that is the shining star of the series. But having this, like, this moment where things come together in a way that makes sense and pays off does feel like it's a reward for having stuck with these IKEA instructions. So yeah, obviously I recommend. That goes without saying with before any of these reviews, because I'm rereading all these books because I love them. This is my third time reading The Last Argument of Kings, so obviously I'm a fan. I'm hoping that through these reviews you can see and understand whether or not this is for you or not, because, like, gushing all day about it makes it sound like this is for anybody and for everybody, which is not the case. But I'm hoping to illustrate why this works so, so well for me, and why these are, like, perfect books for me and for readers like me. But if your tastes don't align with mine, they would not be for you. So helping you to understand what exactly it is that I'm getting out of these, what it is that I love so much about them, so that you can judge for yourself if that sounds like a thing that you would also gush about. I'm hoping at the very least that that's what I've been able to do for you. So let me know in the comments down below if you are a fan of The First Law, and if you agree or disagree with me about my assessment of these books, if you have also read them, or if you're like, I love them, but, like, I don't know what you're talking about. It's not what they're like at all. Feel free to let me know. Or if you haven't read them, you can let me know if I was successful in any way in kind of illustrating what these books are like and whether or not you should be picking them up. Whatever you want to let me know. I post videos on Saturdays, other random times as well, but definitely Saturdays. Also have a Patreon if you want to see me in between. So like and subscribe, and I'll see you when I see you.